You must know what overdetection and overtreatment means in order to estimate your personal risks involved. Should you get tested for prostate cancer? My advice as a urologist with over 20 years of clinical experience is probably yes. There are many benefits linked to a simple blood test called the PSA test. PSA, that's the prostate-specific antigen. It has been in use since the early 90s and is a powerful tool for not only helping to diagnose prostate cancer, but also identify those who are at risk in the years to come. If you are a man, you should watch this video because the things I am going to tell you may have profound implications for your life. 1 in 8 Caucasian men and 1 in 4 men from African descent will face a diagnosis of prostate cancer sometime in the second half of their lives. For the time being, the guidelines of the major urological associations recommend screening for prostate cancer in well-informed men. You must know what overdetection and overtreatment means in order to estimate your personal risks involved should you decide for a PSA test. There is one confusing thing that I want to make very clear at this point. I am only talking about men who feel completely healthy. If you are over 50 and have any symptoms from the lower urinary tract, prostate cancer definitely is one of the differential diagnoses, and early detection of a possible cancer is key in this situation. Screening means a patient walks into the office for a check because his wife sent him. She says, if I have to go to the gynecologist once a year, then you have to go to the urologist. Maybe you are lucky. The urologist finds a tumor just before it was too late and you can be cured. You get on with your life and you are spared the misery with pain, breaking bones, or getting paralyzed and all that wheelchair stuff involved. You chose to get your prostate removed and you had a hell of a surgeon. You are completely continent. Maybe your erections were better before, but this is a small price to pay because you take one of those blue pills and it works beautifully. But it could also be the start of an unpleasant journey without happy end. The urologist thinks your prostate is suspicious and the PSA is slightly above what he would expect to be ideal for you. So a biopsy is taken and cancer cells are found. Your prostate is then removed. You lose urine whenever you get up or cough or lift something, and your erections are mediocre at best. The pathologic report shows cancer, so much is true, but it was a very small one and the cellular changes were not that bad. It would have been better to leave it. In other words, you are cured from something you didn't need cure for. You have been overdiagnosed and overtreated. Plus, that you have to deal with the side effects of the treatment. Why is this happening? Because the natural course of the disease still is not completely understood. We know from cadaver studies that prostate cancer cells form early in a man's life. Prostate cancer cells can be detected in as much as 5% of under 30-year-olds, and this number rises to 59% for men older than 79 years. But despite of an early formation of cancer cells, prostate cancer doesn't start to raise its ugly head until men pass 50, and for most men, it will take until their late 60s when they are diagnosed. Many men will live with these changes until they die from something unrelated to prostate cancer and never will be bothered by these cancerous cells. In others, the cancer will start to grow and spread throughout the body, and they are at risk of dying from the disease. In other words, we don't exactly know why some men get into trouble and others don't. However, I don't want to play down the dangers of prostate cancer because we must not forget that in the US alone, roughly 34,000 men are dying from the disease each year. Some men are more at risk of developing a clinical meaningful cancer than others. It's that hereditary thing. If your father, uncle, brother has prostate cancer, you may be at risk as well. Since prostate cancer is closely related to breast cancer, it doesn't come as a surprise, that germline mutations in the breast cancer genes 1 and 2 go along with an elevated risk for developing prostate cancer in men. You have probably heard of these in the media. As you might remember, in 2013, Angelina Jolie went public that she had a gene mutation in the BRCA1 gene and got a prophylactic mastectomy. If you are of African descent, you have an elevated risk of prostate cancer. We know from population-based studies that dietary and environmental factors play a major role, but since this is very difficult to analyze, no specific recommendations for diet exist at the moment. Other risk factors have been identified, such as men with irritable bowel syndrome and smoking. There are more, but for the sake of the length of this video, I'll leave it at that. If this was way too confusing for you, let's do a short summary. If you have an elevated risk of dying from prostate cancer based on your genetic profile, you should definitely think of getting tested when you turn 40. If you have no obvious risk factors, you may start with a single test at the age of 45. Chances that this test will turn out suspicious are very low. The good thing is, a single test often doesn't mean anything. In order to avoid overdetection and overtreatment, it is smart to get tested at an early age and then observe how PSA develops in the years to come. In many men, the prostate will grow when they age, and this will result in rising PSA levels in the absence of cancer. It will be easier to interpret PSA if it can be compared to prostate growth over time. Additionally, multiparametric MRI becomes more and more standard to avoid overdetection. This is a specialized, high-precision imaging technique of the prostate, which contributes to avoid unnecessary biopsies. I send all of my patients for MRI before I proceed with anything else, because the pictures can be used for targeted biopsies later on. In targeted biopsies, the MRI pictures are downloaded into an ultrasound machine and fused with the real-time images from the ultrasound. This enables precise targeting of the area in question. This approach really contributes to reducing overdetection of prostate cancer. So, does screening provide a benefit in terms of dying from the disease? 16 years of follow-up have passed in the European randomized study of screening for prostate cancer. It shows a reduction of mortality of 29% when non-compliance was eliminated. The number of men who have to be tested and treated to save one life has decreased ever since the first results were published in 2009. Initially, it was 1,410 men who had to take the test to save one life, or 48 men had to be treated for prostate cancer to save one life. Currently, it is 570 men who have to be tested and 18 men have to be treated. There has been and there is a lot of discussion about screening, and there are other studies which showed different results. In 2012, this made the US Preventive Services Task Force issue a recommendation against PSA-based screening. In the years to follow, higher rates of advanced disease were seen due to the lesser testing. This led to a new recommendation in 2017. Men 55 to 69 years should be informed about the benefits and harms, as PSA testing was likely associated with a survival benefit. By the way, if you have never been tested and you are past 70 with considerable comorbidity, it might not be wise to start now, unless you have symptoms. A life expectancy of at least 15 years is recommended, because as a rule, it takes about 10 years from diagnosis until clinical problems develop from the disease. As always, this video is not a surrogate for a medical consultation. If you experience any health issues, book an appointment with your local urologist. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.